Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about languages, language translation, and translation phases as they occur in practice. So let's get started with languages. What is a language? Well, you know English, you know maybe Dutch. These are spoken languages, and whenever you program computers, currently at least, spoken languages are not accepted yet. So we need to have a different way of communicating our intent to the computer whenever we want to program. So for that, we introduce the notion of a formal language. Now, a formal language is in contrast to, for instance, a language, a spoken language, because a formal language is a mathematical construction. And you cannot say that of the language English. Although there is a whole field of linguistics in which the structure of natural language is analyzed. So, and lots of progress has happened there as well. In this course, we focus on formal languages. So what is a formal language? Well, a formal language can be understood if you start with what are the basic elements of a formal language. And for that, we need to have an alphabet. And an alphabet, let's say a finite alphabet, sigma, consists of characters. Characters are individual symbols that you can recognize as such. And to a machine, you typically have character set encodings. The famous ones are the ASCII encoding that numerically encode characters. Other character encodings are possible as well, such as Unicode. Okay, but let's assume that it is clear that we have recognizable characters and that we have finitely many of them. And then these are captured in our alphabet. Then, if we have an alphabet, we can then form sequences of characters from that alphabet. And these finite sequences of characters that you put in order, we call strings. Now, if we have strings, then we can understand what a formal language is, because a formal language is a set of such strings. If a string is in a particular formal language, then we call that string a sentence of that formal language. Okay, so that's a formal language. Now, to give you a concrete idea, here is an example. Suppose our alphabet consists of three characters, A, B, and C. Well, then we can form the following strings. You can form the empty string, but we have to write it somehow. So let's use the special symbol epsilon for the empty string. This is typically done. You can also take one character of the alphabet and form the string of length 1, say with the character A. You can also form strings of a larger length. So suppose you have A and then another A, then you have string of length 2, string of length 3, etc. So to give you an example now of a formal language, let's consider the following set construction. The set L consists of the empty string, the string AA, and the string with four A's, etc. So to better understand what I mean with etc., an equivalent way of describing this formal language as a set of strings would be the formal language L consists of precisely those strings X, such that X has an even number of A's in it. So now you can ask yourself, given an arbitrary string formed from our alphabet, is that string in our formal language L or not? Well, the empty string, for instance, is in the formal language, but the string consisting only of the symbol A is not in our language. The string consisting of two letters A is in our language. So that's an example of a formal language. What can we do with formal languages? Well, given a formal language, let's call it L, does not have to be the example previously given. It can be an arbitrary formal language. Now, we would like to know how can a computer recognize whether a particular string is in our formal language. So whether a particular string is a sentence of our formal language L. Well, for that, we use the notion of recognizers. So let's say that an L recognizer, so a recognizer for the language L, is a program that takes as input a string of characters, and then the program computes and it produces a 1 or a 0 as an output. Now, this is a program, this program is called an L recognizer if furthermore the following properties hold of it. If you know that for a string X, it is in our language L, then if you supply X as an input to the program, then that program must halt and produce a 1. If you now have an X that is not in your language, then if you supply it to the program as an input, then the program may halt, producing a 0. So if you have an L recognizer, then you can call the language L to be recognizable by your computer. Good. So what can we do with recognizers? Well, let's consider the problem of learning a language. So suppose that you have a recognizer of a language, but you don't know how that recognizer works. It is a black box. So now, given some recognizable formal language, then how do you gain knowledge about it? Well, take for instance the C programming language, and we use the C compiler as a recognizer of whether the input to the C compiler is a program or not. So that means if the C compiler rejects the program that you input, then because of the syntax error, then it is not considered to be part of the language. But if the C compiler accepts the language, accepts the program, then it is considered to be part of the language. Okay, so let's then think of the following steps you could take. So it's a typical way to learn a new programming language. You try to write something. And then whenever you have written something and you look at it and it seems acceptable to you, then you can use the compiler, in this case the C compiler, with your written text as input. Now, if the compiler reports a syntax error, then you know that it is not a program. It's not part of the language. So what you could do then next is to change your text. If the compiler does not report a syntax error and it succeeds, well, then you know that the input was indeed part of its language. It is indeed considered to be a program. So what you could do, this process is also called a trial and error. It's a typical way of learning languages. And you keep on trying until the compiler seems to accept your program. And during this process, you start to recognize, certain syntactical constructions are acceptable to the compiler and other syntactical constructions are not. But this, of course, requires your compiler to always give you back a result. If you put in a program and the compiler runs forever, then you will not know whether it actually was a program or not. Why not? Well, because you don't know how long the compiler still has to take. So only whenever it halts, then you know what your program was. Was it a program? Was it considered to be a sentence in your language? Or was there a syntax error and was it not considered a sentence? Okay, so that's one way, but is there maybe a different way to understand a language? Well, for that, there is this notion of a language generator. And a language generator for a formal language L, you can understand as a process for deriving strings. So, to give you a bit of an analogy of how this process works, is suppose you have a machine with a button on it, and each time you press the button, it outputs a new string. And it not only outputs arbitrary strings, but every string that is generated by the machine must be a sentence of your formal language. And now, another property of a language generator is that for every sentence of the formal language L, eventually, so after pressing enough of the button, this sentence will be generated, so will be output of the machine. So if you have such a machine, then you know that there is a language generator for the formal language L. Now, it is an important fact that there is a very close relation between the recognizability of a language and that you can generate its sentences. So what I mean here is recognizers and generators are equipotent. So that means that if you give me a recognizer for the language L, then I can give you back a generator for L. But if you give me a generator for L, then I can give you a recognizer for L. So to give you an idea of how this works, let me show you how that is constructed. So suppose you give me a recognizer for the formal language L. Then I will now show that there must exist a language generator for that same language. So that language generator is constructed as follows. The language generator enumerates all the possible strings. And so since our alphabet is finite, you can imagine that you can try out all the possible strings in a particular ordering, maybe starting from the shortest strings first and the longer strings then later on. So enumerating all these strings, you could then ask yourself for each of the strings that are enumerated, what if you plug it in the recognizer that you have given me? Well, okay, so then each of these strings are then supplied as an input to the recognizer of L, and these recognizers then start to work. So for each of the strings, we have a separate recognizer and we put that string as input. Now, as soon as one of the recognizers halts and produces a 1, then we know that the string we have supplied as an input must be a sentence, because that's what a recognizer does. So as soon as a recognizer produces a 1, then we, as a language generator, then can say that that string is now generated. So to show that it is a generator, this construction, we have to show that indeed it is the case that every generated string by this generator is a sentence of L. Well, that follows because a recognizer for L will always halt whenever it is supplied an input that is indeed a sentence of L. So as soon as our generator generates a string, if such a recognizer halts and produces 1, well, then we know that everything that is generated by this generator must be a sentence. Now, the second condition to be a generator was that for every sentence, this sentence will be eventually generated. And the insight here is that every sentence itself must be a string. And since we enumerate all the strings in a particular ordering, say from the shortest to the longest in that order, eventually, we will reach the point where we will start the recognition process for checking whether the generated string was a sentence or not. So we must assume here that all the previous recognizers either have all terminated or are still busy. So it is important here that you have this notion of trying things in parallel. So while the recognizer is still busy on maybe earlier strings that were enumerated, maybe a later recognizer already halts and produces a 1. Well, if that is the case, then eventually every sentence of the language will be generated by this construction. Okay, the other direction is, suppose that you give me a language generator, then now I prove to you that there exists a recognizer for the same language. So the construction is the following. So the recognizer takes as an input some input string, and then it starts operating the generator that you have supplied me. So this recognizer starts pushing the button. And each time it pushes the button, a sentence comes out. So what do? We check whether the sentence that came out was equal to the supplied input. And if that is the case, well, then the recognizer outputs one and it stops. If it is not equal to the input, well, then it keeps on generating sentences and comparing whatever was generated with the input string. So now to show that this is indeed a recognizer that we have constructed, we have to show for a given input x that if x was indeed a sentence, that then the recognizer halts and produces a 1. Well, we know from the generator that eventually every sentence will be produced. So if the input x is a sentence, then we only have to push the button finitely many times, and then eventually it will generate the sentence that is identical to our input. So then we will stop and output the 1. Now, if the given input is not in our language, well, then our recognizer never halts. But this is fine, because a recognizer may halt and produce a 0 whenever the input is not a sentence. Okay, so that is language generators and language recognizers, and they are tightly related to each other. A next concept for formal languages is language deciders. So if you're given a formal language L, then you can ask yourself, can we do more than just recognizing whether an input is a sentence? Can we not characterize for every possible input whether it is in or out of our language? And so then when we go back to this example of the C compiler, if the C compiler always halts, then you will always know that your given program either contained a syntax error or it was accepted as a program in the C programming language. So this characteristic function f is defined to give you a 1 whenever the argument x is in the formal language, and this characteristic function f is defined to be 0 whenever x is not in your formal language. So then, whenever f is computable, then we call the formal language L decidable by a computer. Okay, now let's compare the notion of recognizability and, in this case, decidability of a language. But before we do that, maybe you can think of a language that is undecidable, a formal language that is undecidable. Well, and this is, for instance, very closely related to the previous lecture's halting problem that was introduced there. Okay, but let's compare language recognizers with language deciders. So this was the definition of a language recognizer. Yeah, so a language recognizer takes a string of characters as input and it produces one or a zero as an output, such that it must halt whenever the supplied input was a sentence, and it may halt whenever the supplied input is not a sentence. But for a language decider, you could give an equivalent definition, which would be this. So a language decider is a program that takes a string of characters as input that produces a 1 or 0 as output. But now it is the case that if the input is a sentence, then this program must halt produce a 1. And if the input is not a sentence, then also the program must halt producing a 0. So you can see the difference between recognition and deciders in the must and may considering the output. So you know that this decidable language is associated to a program for which you know that that program must terminate. Okay. The next topic is translations between languages. Because can we now understand languages in different ways? We have seen languages that can be recognized or generated, and these two notions are the same. We have seen languages for which there exists a decider. Very useful, because then you don't have to wait forever. But are there also other ways of understanding a language? Well, suppose you have already learned a language, say the C programming language, and now you want to learn a new language, like C++. Well, what if you can then translate every program in the C++ language into a program of the C language? Then by this translation, you can then understand what is the relation between the programming languages. So the notion of translation is very common. You can understand translations in a very general way as being a function that maps strings of characters to strings of characters. And so as soon as you have a function that maps strings of characters to strings of characters, you can call that function a translation. Now, there are certain properties of translations that are interesting. So for example, this translation is called mapping if it is the case that as soon as you supply a sentence of the language L into your translation, that it must produce a sentence in your language L prime. So then if this translation is mapping language L to language L prime, then you know that all the sentences of L can be translated to sentences of L prime. A different property of a translation would be whether it's covering. So a translation is called a covering whenever it is the case that for every possible sentence in L prime, there is a sentence in L that translates to it. As you can see in the picture now, for every sentence in L, so let's call them sentences in L, those are these dots within the L prime. For every sentence in L prime, there must exist a sentence in L that translates to it. But this translation could also map other sentences of L to things that are outside of L prime, and that is not important for covering. Now, a translation could both be a mapping and a covering. In that case, every sentence of L must be translated into a sentence of L prime, and moreover, every sentence in L prime must have a sentence in L that translates to it. Another interesting translation is whenever you translate a language into itself. And in that case, you call it a self-translation. Self-translation, well, it's a mapping, so every sentence that you put into the translation stays within the language. Now, let's continue a little bit. So these are the sort of the more theoretical concepts. How can these theoretical concepts be understood in practice? Well, let's look at a number of examples of translations between languages. So one example of a translation between languages is what is called a transpiler. A transpiler takes in a high-level programming language and it produces a high-level programming language. It could even be a self-translation. It could even be the case that the transpiler takes programs from the same programming language as that it produces. A compiler is an example of a translation that takes a high-level programming language and produces a low-level programming language. An example of that would, for instance, be the C compiler that takes C programs as input and produces assembly programs as output. An assembler is an example of a translation that goes from a low-level language, where you can understand the alphabet to be the human-readable alphabet, and then translates that low-level language into machine code, which you can understand as a formal language in which the alphabet are the zeros and the ones. Now, you could also think of translations that are in the opposite direction. So there is this thing called a disassembler, and a disassembler takes machine code, so the sequence of zeros and ones, and it then outputs a human-readable low-level assembly program. And the nice thing of a disassembler is the following. Suppose you start with machine code, and you then disassemble it to obtain a humanly-readable low-level assembly, then if you then use that output and then use the assembler again, then what you expect is to obtain the identical machine code. Now, there is also another interesting translation, which is called a decompiler. A decompiler takes a low-level language and it tries to recognize the patterns in that low-level language and gives you back a high-level a program in a high-level language. So you could indeed imagine that you could form a pipeline with all these translations in between. So suppose you start with a high-level programming language like C, then you use the C compiler to go to assembly, then you use an assembler to go to machine code, then you use a disassembler, and then you obtain assembly again, and then you use a decompiler, and then you obtain a C program again. Now the question is, was the original program, how does it compare, the original program, to the program that you got from the end of this pipeline? Well, and it turns out that a lot of information is lost in the way. For example, a compiler often makes use of a so-called optimization stage or phase. And in the optimization phase, the compiler will perform optimizations by eliminating code that was originally present, but it is inefficient and can be translated in a more efficient way, so that the execution of the program becomes more efficient. Now, whenever you then decompile, or first disassemble and then decompile the result of such an optimization, the code is typically less readable than it was in its original form. Okay, so these are examples of translations as they occur in practice. Now, the compiler itself is a very intricate translation process. You can understand it abstractly as you put in a program and outputs comes an assembler. But how does the compiler actually work? Well, to understand that, I can give you the typical phases in which the compiler is performing the translation. These are the following. So a compiler typically starts with analyzing the text, so the source text of its input. And now this text analysis is called a lexical analysis. A lexical analysis is then followed by what is called a syntax analysis. So where in the lexical analysis, the compiler will recognize very tiny patterns that are present within the source text, the syntax analyzer tries to recognize larger patterns, like grammatical patterns in the source text. After the syntax has also been analyzed, the compiler typically goes into the next phase, which is called the static semantic analysis. And the static semantic analysis typically includes processes such as type checking. It checks that there are certain well-formedness conditions on the grammar. And these can all be checked statically. So the compiler can all perform these functions without executing anything. Then this is just the input stage of the compiler. So after the static semantic analysis has been done, we now want to go to the output phases of the compiler. And typically the output phases consist first of an intermediary code generation. An intermediary code is a simplified format that is used internally within the compiler to represent the program. Now the intermediary code is called that way because it is not yet the final code that it will output at the end of the compilation process. But it is chosen in such a way that this intermediary code can typically output for a wide variety of machine codes. And so suppose, for instance, that you have an Intel machine or that you have different kinds of machines, such as a power PC, then a compiler can use the same intermediary code that will eventually then output at the end the machine code that is acceptable by an Intel processor or the machine code that is acceptable by a power PC. The nice thing of the intermediary code is that it allows for optimization. And this is where a code optimizer comes in. And a code optimizer can indeed be understood as a self-translation. It namely takes the intermediary code as an input and it again produces intermediary code as an output. And the optimizer can be run in a number of cycles, further and further and further optimizing the code. The final stage of a compiler is the final code generator. And this is where your output happens. And so that code generator typically outputs then assembly code. Now, for each of these phases, let me give you a little bit of an idea of what these phases comprise. By naming you some terms that you can then later search for if you want to know more about each of these phases. So the lexical analysis typically does things called pattern matching. So it matches and recognizes syntactical patterns that are closely together within the source text. And the pattern matching typically is done so that it could recognize symbols or keywords or, for instance, identifiers, names, as entities in themselves. These entities are typically called tokens. And then the tokens are then grouped together characters that you can then treat as one unit instead of separated characters. And this is very useful because then in the next phase of the syntactic analysis, this can directly work with these tokens instead of all the individual characters of your alphabet. So in the syntactical analysis phase, you typically want to transform a so-called token string, so that is a string consisting of tokens, into a parse tree. And in the next videos, I will explain a little bit in more detail how this is done. Now, in the next a syntactic analysis also deals with the notion of an abstract syntax tree. And why is this called an abstract syntax tree? Well, it abstracts away from irrelevant details that are present in your input. So for instance, if your source code consists of a lot of comments, well, all these comments are thrown away because they do not influence the behavior of programs. The abstract syntax tree tries to find the grammatically simplest way of representing your program. So on this abstract syntax tree, then a static semantic analysis can happen. In the next lecture, by the way, I will explain more about static semantic analysis. In this step of the compiler, processes like name resolution or importing libraries or binding variables to certain locations or types are checked. So these are more advanced operations that all operate on the syntax tree, the abstract syntax tree. Now, these operations then lead to a so-called decorated syntax tree. So you go from a syntax tree which has the least amount of information that could be extracted from the input, and then it decorates it by inferring information from the context. And this is then called decorated syntax tree. So the decorated syntax tree then is then transformed into intermediary code in the fourth phase. Now, as I already told you, the intermediary code generator makes use of an internal format, and this format precisely captures what is stored in the decorated syntax tree. I also already told you that the intermediary code generator is structured in such a way that it can be used for different outputs, such as an Intel processor or a PowerPC processor later on. The code optimizer is this self-translation process. And an example of a code optimizer would be a dead code elimination. So what is dead code elimination? The optimizer could recognize that in your source program, certain statements or certain declarations are never used. And if they are never used, then you don't have to output them. Yeah, because if it's not used, then it can never influence the behavior of the program whenever it is running. So you can then eliminate the code to keep the output reasonably small. But there are numerous other optimizations as well that can be performed in this phase. And the course on compiler construction that happens later in the bachelor will dive into the details of code optimizations. In this course, we will not treat it. Now, the final code generator is interesting because it takes this intermediary code, so this decorated syntax tree, and then it layouts and it tries to allocate certain structures such that the output format can be such that you can produce assembly in the output format as it is required. So that is in a nutshell what a compiler does and its numbers of phases. Now, if you really want to go into practice, then these six stages or these six phases are not alone. So for instance, if you look at the programming language Scala by Martin Oderski and others, then if you look at how many phases does that compiler have, well, it has 25 phases. That's a lot more than six. But the six are typical, so they occur in most compilers. Now, if you're interested, you can dive into the details, but let's end this video for now. So thank you for watching, and I hope to see you soon again.